Sweet. Yeah. Am I talking too fast? I talk really fast.
I'm
trying to guess.
I'm like, no.
No, but it's
My name is Joel Boyd. I'm the designer and founder of the menswear brand JOBO.
I'm Daya, and I'm a singer-songwriter originally from Pittsburgh. For me, preparing for a show means like months of rehearsals and getting like the creative down and the visuals for stage and stuff like that. But right before a show, it takes me like I have to block out like an hour to prepare mentally, but. But it's like really just months of prep before that.
I think the difference is like when it comes to like the day before the show or whenever the show is, it's still like it's chaotic. It's probably like the most chaotic. In your head, you think, yeah, it's gonna be fine. I'm gonna be able to go get my hair cut. I'm gonna be able to go, you know. But like the last show I did, I ended up the night before looking for like a 24-hour printer to print off some like leaflets, you know, so like it's always something till the last minute.
Well, I have to have it be pitch black when I sing. It has to be like no one can see me because I like to be comfortable and I like to have that just be the main focus. And if I'm not, like, if I'm worried about other things or what I look like or whatever, then the product isn't going to come out as well. So I have to have it be like, producers get so annoyed because they're like, who am I speaking to? But no, I have to have it like that. And then I just wear, I usually wear sweats or something comfy just to have the focus all be on the music.
Yeah, mine's the same. Has to be pitch black. I'm really messy. But, it is pretty, besides the pitch black, it's 100% the same. I have to be, super comfortable. I've never dressed up, you know, rings are the worst thing to draw a pattern with. So it's no rings in my baggy joggers, you know. At the end of the day, health is wealth, you know? So it's you have to make sure that one, that your environment is optimized for you to perform in the way you want to perform or create, and that you can still check in on yourself.
Yeah, no, I feel the same with self-check-ins and everything. I think that mentality is the most important thing for me in studio. I have to have an environment that makes me feel comfortable enough to, you know, be creative. And I mean, you know, you're in such an intimate space with people, and especially emotionally, I have to be in my comfort zone in order to really dig into what I want to say.
One of my milestones is I'd love to do set designs for movies. So I'd love to do a sci-fi movie. Maybe someone like Stanley Kubrick.
Of someone's music who I love recently is Rosalia, and I love her visuals too. Her music videos are really, really cool, and her whole persona and stage performance and stuff like that. So yeah, I would love to collaborate with her. I think she's doing something really cool and unconventional with her music, and she's kind of transforming traditional flamenco into
it's amazing.
A new sound. Yeah. So yeah, she's someone that I would definitely want to sing with. For me, I've written this album probably 5 times over. I get in and out of these slumps. I think that was a hard thing for me at first to deal with the fact that this is me and I'm putting myself out there in the world and being super vulnerable with it. But I think over the past couple of years, I've kind of let that guard down, and that's helped me to open my mind more creatively to what it could be.
I feel like I'm kind of getting out of it, but from February until maybe last month, I was in a bit of a slump because that Fashion Week, just finished Fashion Week. So, you know, you're kind of burnt out, you want to relax. And I kind of I like video games. So I was once I'm done, I'm going to buy Red Dead Redemption, just going to play it. So I was just okay, cool, play that. And then I was actually, I need to get some work done. Do you know, it was it wasn't one of those, oh my gosh, I don't want to do anything type of things. It's just okay, I need to get back into the headspace.
I mean, you're from, are you from here?
Yeah, born and raised.
Yeah, so we have different kind of perceptions of it, but London for me is like, it's just like an epicenter of like authentic creativity. I feel like LA, you kind of get like lost in the shuffle of things a bit, and just like status and all of that kind of factors into it a lot more than it should. And I feel like with London, it's just like very real, and there's so many people here who are just like lifting each other up and kind of inspiring and feeding off of one another. So I feel like that collaboration is really what draws me to the city. I love London.
I was born here, grew up in, I mean, I grew up in Lewisham, I still live in Lewisham, my studio is based in Lewisham, you know, so. I anytime I hear anyone like, anyone bigging up London, I'm like, yeah, you know what I mean? Like, but yeah, for me, man, it's just like, it's just this amazing center of, like you said, like there's so much energy from creatives that are building up on each other. I love the DIY nature of London as well. It is very much like, okay, cool, if nobody's doing that, I'm gonna do that. Or if nobody wants to put me on, I'm gonna put myself on, you know? And it's like, I'm just gonna keep going at it and at it. I think that's the energy that kind of carries London, and you just see it through so many people's work, you know? It's just like, cool. If I want to do this because of this, and nobody's gonna stop me. I think for me, music is probably like the biggest kind of inspiration for me when it comes to making stuff. Before I started making my brand, I used to run my own little radio show. It's like I always wanted to include music in what I do. When I made my first collection, my whole idea was for the presentation, I wanted a grime rave.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with that too. I think the collaboration between the two is so important. I think for me, like I don't feel like I can put on my best performance if I'm walking on stage and something that I don't feel is like elevated or, you know, makes me feel good. I feel like they just tie into each other so well, and I think they blend into each other really well and really just organically. It's so exciting to be in a place where I can play with that and have relationships with designers and have collaborations that really help me to express myself in the best way. I think just being like a young female and a male dominant space, especially when I was 16, and trying to assert myself as a writer, not only like the singer and the performer, but the writer and the mind behind what I was putting out and the art that I was making. I feel like that was hard, and it's hard for people, for females that I work with, no matter how old they are, how young they are. I think it's just like, it's just, it's kind of just innately there. It was really important for me to be surrounded by so many like female creatives and look up to so many female creatives, so whether songwriters, producers, designers, artists, whatever, who showed me that there is a way to kind of overcome that.
Everybody wants to be a singer or a designer or whatever, you know? So it's like, when you're coming up, you are constantly having to like get through this like pool of like millions of others to be noticed, you know? And I think that is a massive challenge. That's what really ends up separating who really deserves it. Cause it's like, if it's like, okay, cool, whatever. There's this person, I'm just gonna keep going. I'm gonna keep going and going until it's my time. I think that's what separates the frauds for the people that really love the craft, you know? And I think that in itself is, it's a mental, as much a mental thing as it is like just a endurance thing.
Yeah, I think even like with all like marginalized groups, I feel like it's like, it also just like taught me to work so much harder.
It's that thing twice
just
as hard.
Just like, yeah, twice as hard to even get a seat at the table. So I feel like it's been, you know, like a blessing and a curse.
Yeah. For me, I was curious, but I didn't like asking questions. So like, if I need to know something, I'd either try to read a book out, or I'd just like fail until somebody can see that I need a hand. So I think I'd probably say, ask all the questions, get as much information as you want to my younger self, you know, because I've always liked learning each aspect, and that's kind of what got me into fashion. I think I kind of held myself back a little bit just by not asking the questions when the wealth of knowledge was there.
I think kind of along those lines, just trust yourself and trust that you know what's best for you at the moment, and that it's, you might not fall into the right thing at the right time, but that will come along soon enough. I think just to know that there's not like just one trajectory laid out ahead of you, and there's so many endless opportunities, I mean, always. So just take advantage and take care of yourself and take care of the moments that are like the opportunities that present themselves to you, because yeah, you only get that chance once. Yeah. It's cheesy, but it's real. It's real.
You know, every time I kind of make a collection or do something, I kind of always think about like, I think it's like appreciating what is going on around you, and then just kind of like taking the inspiration from what's around me at least, you know, and then using that.
I think there's just endless inspirations in growing up. Amy Winehouse was a big one. Just all of the female vocalists who were just super raw and real with their lyrics. And I think just anyone who takes chances and pushes the boundaries. Yeah, there was this one show in Minnesota, I think, and it was like right when I was starting out. I had these pants that I was really excited to wear. They were these like silver, tight silver pants, nothing that I would ever wear now, but I was really excited about it at the time. And the zipper was in the back, and I was going to the bathroom right before my performance. I was trying to get my pants up after I went to the bathroom, and the zipper got stuck, and it just was not, I had like four people around me trying to make it work, and it was not working. And so eventually we broke the zipper off, so like my ass was just hanging out of these pants, and I had no clothes with me, I had like no other wardrobe options except for this leather jacket that I was wearing on top. So I tied that around my waist. I performed like this the whole time, just like this. So yeah, that was not fun.
I can remember like one of my funniest memories of backstage. First year of uni, and we were helping out the final years for their graduate fashion week. Me and my friend were the only guys on the course, and one of the tutors kind of like tricked us into building the whole set for the whole thing. One of our tutors was like, yeah, I'll be there to help. Didn't come at all, so it was just me and my mate building this. We have no clue what we're doing. And then we had to dress the model. So by the time that happened, we were just like, all right, look, let's just go get a couple beers and have a couple drinks, you know? So we just ended up, we ended up getting to the point where it was like, okay, we can't drink anymore because we actually, if you have one more, it's gonna be a problem. We always quote the email that our tutor sent us. It was like, he sent this like massive speech. It's like, three people have to do it. Two people can't do it, three can. And then we get there, it's just me and him. So we're just like, what do you mean? Where's the three? So every time we see each other every night, it's like, take three people, not two. So yeah, that's one of my funniest, but or fondest memories. I can't tell you the others. I'm trying to